Welcome to the Securities Industry Essentials Examination Podcast, audio lessons for the SIE exam. This is lesson number 5, Fixed Income Securities, and in the outline, this is going to be covering parts of section 2.1.2. And this is going to be the first part of a 3-part series of lessons on basic fixed income investments. Now, fixed income investments differ from equities. And I've always told people there's really only 2 types of investments in this world. There's equity, which is the owners, and there's debt, which are the loaners. The owners and the loaners. Those are the only 2 types of investments. Wall Street comes out with all sorts of arcane strategies, but when it really comes down to it, you're either a lender or an owner, one or the two. Now you have options, which are speculations, and you have commodities that are speculations, and both can offer hedges, which can protect your securities or protect your portfolio sometimes, not all the time. But these are not investments. These are different strategies that you use as an investor to do other things with your portfolio. But there's really only 2 types of investments. There's equity, and we've had 3 episodes of equities. We've had common stocks, we've had preferred stocks, and then we've had special securities, which covered rights, warrants, and ADRs, American Depository Receipts. This is the first one that's really specifically dealing with fixed income investments. So when you buy a fixed income investment, you will buy a fixed income investment with a stated par value. And we talked about this in common and preferred stock. But in fixed income investments, this is the face value of the bond or the Ginnie Mae or the Fannie Mae or the government bond or the government bill or the government note. These are all fixed income investments. But they all come with a par value, a stated maturity value. And that's what you're going to get when it matures, the par value. Now, this is assuming that you're buying a bond or a fixed income investment in a company that actually can pay off the bond. Okay, in the case of government bonds, they are considered risk-free, so you will be asked on this. It's the only risk-free investment out there is what they call government bonds. Now, we could get into a big discussion on that, but we're not going to, because what's safe is a matter of interpretation. So they come with a par value or a maturity value. That's what they will mature at. They come with a stated interest rate, and the interest rate is stated on the par value. There's an exception to this, and that is zero coupon bonds. Zero coupon bonds are a special case, and we'll be talking about those. There's also a stated maturity value, a date when you get back your par value or your maturity value on the fixed income investment. Now, there's a few other things that can be added into fixed income investments, and these are call features. Just like in preferred stocks, fixed income securities have call features, may have call features. There's some. And the exception that you can usually count on are government bonds. U.S. government bonds have no call features. There may be sinking funds, and sinking funds are simply a portion of money set aside every year to buy back bonds. These are usually seen in municipal fixed income investments or municipal bonds. And then you have another type of investment, another type of fixed income investments that are collateralized mortgage obligations. These would include Ginnie Mae's or Fannie Mae's or Freddie Mac's. And these are basically the mortgage investments where every month you receive principal and interest, just like you're on the receiving end of your house payment. And these are a special case that we'll discuss later as well. And then there's zero coupon bonds. Zero coupon bonds have no interest, stated interest rate, and they have no interest payment dates, but you buy these bonds at a discount and they may mature at par value. And the difference between what you buy the bond at and what it matures at is the calculated yield. So for instance, let's say you bought a zero coupon bond that matured in 5 years and you paid $900 for a $1,000 maturity value on the bond. Your interest would be that $100 over that period of time. And there you need to use a bond calculator to calculate what that yield becomes. In the business, almost every financial professional will have on his desk a bond calculator. And usually it's a HP 12C, Hewlett-Packard 12C. It's been around for a long time, I think over 30 years, and they're still being used today. I have one on my desk. You can get emulators that you can stick on your smartphone that look just like an HP 12C, but most people will have the actual physical calculator. They're not too expensive, and it has not changed. It's been a wonderful product to have in the financial services industry. You will not be allowed to use this calculator in the Series 7 examination. So you should not have problems that would require the use of a bond calculator. They will ask questions that relate to movements of fixed income investments, but you will not be required to calculate difficult calculations to arrive at interest rates on zero coupon bonds or those sort of things. But you will be expected to understand the concepts behind them, and you will be tested extensively on the concepts. There's some formulas that will calculate the zero coupon bonds. These are outlined in the video. There's no reason to try to go over them in an audio. But give you an example. Let's say you had a zero coupon bond that matures at $1,000. And the bond is priced currently in the marketplace at $860. So that's what you're going to be paying for that bond. Now, in bond terms, the par value is 100, and 100 on this bond would be $1,000, and the price would be 86, and the 86 would be $860. Now, let's say there's 10 years before this bond matures at par value. Plugging that into a bond calculator gives you a yield of 1.52% per year. We have some other examples on the videos. There's no reason to go through them. That's the basic concept of a zero coupon bond. You're buying a bond at a discount and it matures at par. Term bonds are the most what you think of when you buy bonds. And these are simply bonds that you buy at a certain price that mature at par value. They have a specific maturity date, a specific interest rate, and a specific interest payment date. An example of this might be, so let's say a General Electric Corporation issues a bond with $1,000 par value, interest rate at 5%, maturing in 10 years, payable semi-annually. And bonds usually pay semi-annual, but some bonds pay annual. You need to look at the specific bond to find out exactly when the bond pays its interest. So if you bought this bond at par when it was issued, you would be expecting 5% per year over the life of that bond. So you'd be getting $50 interest per year, or $25 per interest payment date if it pays on a semi-annual basis. And you'll get that $1,000 back in 10 years. That's when you can get your investment back in full if you bought it at par in 10 years. Serial bonds are another concept you will be expected to understand. Serial bonds is basically one bond issue, but with varying maturity dates. And each maturity date in a serial bond issue will carry a different interest rate. Serial bonds are normally issued by municipalities. Understanding yields is important. Typically, in a normal yield curve, and we'll talk in detail about yield curves later on, but in a normal yield curve environment, the shorter the maturity on a fixed income investment, the lower the yield, and the longer maturity has the higher yield. There have been exceptions over the years, particularly in the very short end of the yield spectrum, where we sometimes have had what are called inverted yield curves, where shorter-term bonds carry a higher yield than longer-term bonds. This is an anomaly, but it does occur. I've seen it happen several times in my career for periods of time. We have some examples in the videos of actual serial bond issues. We can't really show those here, but let me just try to describe what a serial bond issue. Let's say you have a bond issued by a municipality, a $10 million serial bond issue, and you might have $1 million maturing in 2015, $1 million maturing in 2016, and so forth on out to 2024 when the other $1 million matures. That's the total $10 million issue. So you have maturities over that full 10-year period of time. The shorter the period, the shorter the maturity, the lower the interest. In this example, we go from 2.1% for the bonds maturing in 2015, stepping up usually 10 basis points per year up to a high of 3% for the bonds maturing in 2024. This is just an example of what a serial bond issue looks like. You can also have serial bonds with a balloon maturity, and this is just like a serial bond, but you might have a balloon maturity of more than the usual annual maturity at one point in time in the bond issue. For instance, you might have a bond maturing in 2019, 2020, 2021, 2022, 2023. All those maturities might be for $1 million per year. And then you might have a maturity in 2024 for $5 million. So that would be the balloon, the $5 million maturity in 2024. Series bonds, you will also be asked about. And series bonds are sort of the opposite of a serial bond. A series bond are, you know, they're issued for cash management reasons, usually by municipalities. And the reason you would use a series bond issue is because you don't need all the money up front. You need it over a period of time. This might be the case of a construction project that will be taking multiple years to put together. You don't need all the cash up front, but you do need the cash as the construction project moves along. So you might issue a certain specific number of bonds at specific times over the construction project. So the total issue would be for the full size of the project, but you would be issuing the bonds in a series of steps as you need the cash. And the goal of this is you're minimizing the total interest rate paid because the principal will build up over the series of issues, not all at the beginning. A key concept, a very, very key concept that you need to understand is how interest rate movements impact bond prices. And here we're talking about the secondary market for bonds. And the secondary market is simply bonds that have been issued and are now trading in the market. Now think about it. Once a bond has been issued and it's trading in the bond market, assuming there's not going to be a default on the bond, all of its future payouts are already determined. We know how much interest it's going to pay. We know when the maturity is. The only thing that can really vary is the asking price on the bond in the secondary market. And this is a key concept. When interest rates go up, bond prices on the secondary market go down, and vice versa. When interest rates go down, then bond prices go up. So when you're listening to the financial news and they say bond prices went up today, what is that telling you? Well, that's telling you that interest rates went down that day. It's hard for a lot of people to grasp this concept, but we'll go through some examples. And there's a formula. We're not going to talk about the formula. It's too difficult to verbally describe what the formula is. It's better to see that in your own study material that you're going through. Now, let's go through a couple examples here. Suppose on the secondary market, you're buying a bond at $950 or $95, okay? And it has a coupon rate of 7% and it matures in 4 years. The par value of the bond is $100 or $1,000 per bond when it matures. So you need to calculate the yield to maturity. To do this, you would use a bond calculator. And in this case, the bond calculator would arrive at 8.53%. Now think about this. This is a 7% coupon. It matures in 4 years. But the yield to maturity is 8.53%. And the reason that yield maturity is 8.53% is you're buying the bond at a discount. You're buying the bond at $95 or $950 per bond. Yet when the bond matures, you're going to be getting $1,000 for that bond. So that extra $50 over that 4 year period of time increases your yield from the 7% coupon to 8.53% yield to maturity. Now the current yield, and this is a formula you will be tested on, is simply the income you're getting per year, in this case $70 per year, divided by the price you're paying for that bond, or $950. So your current yield is 7.37%. So the yield to maturity in this case is 8.53%. The current yield is 7.37%, and the coupon yield is 7%. This relationship, when you're buying a bond at a discount, will always remain constant. Your yield to maturity will always be the greatest yield. Your current yield will be the next highest yield, and your coupon yield will be your lowest yield. Now, the opposite is the case when you buy a premium bond. And we go through some examples of that in the video. But if you buy a bond at par, then the current yield, the yield to maturity, and the coupon yield are all the same. Now let's go through another example of buying a bond at a premium. Suppose you buy a bond at $1,115 per $1,000 face value. So you'd buy the bond at $115. That would be the price quote on it, $115. Has a coupon rate of 7%, matures in 4 years, and the par value is $1,000. What's the yield to maturity? Using a bond calculator, the yield to maturity now is 7.968%. And the current yield is now the $70 divided by the $1,150 or 6.86%. When you're talking to a client and you're selling them a premium bond, you need to make sure you quote the most conservative yield. And the most conservative yield in this case, the most conservative yield in this case is the yield to maturity of 2.98%. Now, if there were a call feature on this, let's say the bond could be called in 2 years, you would need to calculate the yield to call. And the yield to call could be substantially less than that. You need to quote the most conservative yield to your customer. You need to understand what bond accretion is or bond depletion is, and we've already discussed it. Basically, if you buy a bond at a discount, let's say at 95 and it matures at 100, between 95 and 100 is called bond accretion. Depletion is the opposite. Sometimes depletion is called depreciation. Either word works. Basically, that would be the devaluation of your bond to par if you buy a bond at premium. Now, you'll be asked some questions on bond accretion and bond depletion. There's some special tax treatments for bonds bought at a discount or bought at a premium. You may be asked questions on tax treatment. This changes from year to year. But if you bought a taxable bond, not a municipal bond, but a taxable bond at a discount, and it's redeemed at maturity, this difference represents the market discount, which is really additional interest to you over the life of the bond. It is not eligible for capital gains treatment and has to be reported as ordinary taxable interest income. But if you buy a tax-exempt bond at a discount and it's redeemed at maturity, your adjusted cost basis is par value. Now, let's say you buy a bond at a premium, a taxable bond bought at a premium, and this is under the current tax scenario. The investor can choose whether to amortize the premium two different ways. The premium is adjusted to cost basis in the bond downward by a certain amount each year so that at maturity, it's equal to par. The amortized amount each year can be deducted from your income. But if you don't choose that, you can then, when the bond matures, take the difference between the premium and the maturity as a capital loss. In a tax-exempt bond, you are to amortize a premium over the life of the bond, but you don't get to deduct the amortized portion of the premium from your income. So that's going to do it for this lesson. Let's review what you should have learned. What are the characteristics of a fixed income investment? What about call features and sinking funds? What are they? Ginnie Mae's, Fannie Mae's, Freddie Mac's. We're going to go into those in a lot more detail in other podcasts, so don't worry about that one too much. What are zero coupon bonds? You do need to understand what a zero coupon bond. The formulas, you can't really know, but you can learn that from your books or from the videos. Term bonds, serial bonds with balloon maturities, series bonds, what are they? What's the reason for a series bonds? And the big one, the big, big one that you need to understand, what are the impact of interest rate movements on the secondary price of bonds? How do you determine the yield to maturity? How do you determine current yield? You will be tested on current yields. It's a very simple calculation. You need to understand how to calculate current yields, both in bonds and preferred stocks and common stocks. What's bond accretion or depletion? And what's the tax treatment of bonds bought at a discount or a premium? So this is the last of the five lessons that you've been listening to for the Securities Industry's Essentials Exam audio course. This is only a portion of the 71 audio files which are available in the full course. The full course is 36 hours and around 35 minutes in total length, and it consists of 71 audio files, which include 58 individual audio lessons for the Securities Industry's Essentials Examination, plus an 11 audio lessons of bonus material. So if this has been valuable to you to listen to these first five lessons, please go to siepodcast.com and purchase the full bundle of lessons. And you would buy these bundles of lessons through a service called Gumroad. Best of luck in your studies. If you have any thoughts or suggestions, feel free to write me, Franz@siepodcast.com. Thank you for listening. SIEPodcast.com.